one, long and detailed, but relationships were built up and trust will be key. And as Taoiseach, I will work very hard to maintain that harmony and that common purpose, unity of purpose, amongst the three parties and all of the ministers. And I think there was a very good sense at our first cabinet meeting that we really had to work together, putting the country before party self-interest. To illustrate that, this morning, for example, I met with Minister of Foreign Affairs and Defence, Simon Coveney, to jointly discuss Brexit or approach to Brexit and indeed to Northern Ireland. And that's the model. You saw Pascal Donoghue and Michael McGrath today announcing the Exchequer return figures. And that's how it has to work, and there has to be genuine trust. And we have no time to waste. Ministers are already in their departments working hard on the programme for government, and that's the way it has to be.
Nevertheless, Leo Varadkar has said that you didn't coordinate on the cabinet appointments, and that led to a lot of criticism in your very first days. So what does that say about the working relationship in reality?
You will always get criticism on the first day. It's very tough. Former Taoiseach will tell you one of the toughest days they have is appointing a cabinet or indeed appointing ministers of state. And I understand that because it is extremely difficult for many individuals who were not selected. And I understand that. I can understand people who've
been...
But
should you have coordinated more, though, between the parties?
Well, it was difficult. We coordinated on the portfolios, or we worked on portfolios in terms of the allocation of those. I think it's difficult, in terms of the appointing of individuals, because one has to talk to individuals, one has to discuss it with them. And we both had different sets of circumstances, whereas in the Taoiseach's case, there were many ministers losing office. In our case, because we haven't been in power for 10 years, or in government for 10 years, there was a pent-up sort of anticipation and desire, understandable, for many, many people to become a minister. And unfortunately, we didn't have enough positions. So, likewise with the Green, it had its issues.
But one of those most disappointed, and it dominated your first few days in office, was your deputy leader, Dara Cailleary, who voiced his disappointment and his anger here on 6-1 and elsewhere. Government Chief Whip to the man who was your chief negotiator for the programme for government. Many people would say, how could you do that to him?
Well, first of all, there was no chief negotiator. There was a very strong negotiating team. And obviously, the portfolios we have are in terms of housing and health and public expenditure. I was very anxious to hit the ground running on those. And Dara O'Brien in housing, for example, has been covering that for a number of years as opposition spokesperson. Likewise, with Stephen Donnelly. So from that perspective, it is very difficult and it's very tough. But Chief Whip is a very important and influential position in any government.
But and do I you think anyone believes, not least Dara Cailleary, that... Yeah. Government Chief Whip is equal to being a minister of a
department? Well, I can go through the likes of Seamus Brennan, Dermot Ahern, Bertie Ahern himself, others, all were chief whips. They wield significant influence. They're at the cabinet table. They work with ministers. They work with the parliamentary parties. And in fact, back to your original question, a tripartite government, I need an experienced, able person who understands Dáil Éireann to pull this together in terms of the legislative programme. For example, we have a very heavy legislative programme in July to deal with the job stimulus programme and economic recovery. Dara is working very hard on that now. It's very difficult. It's very tough on him. He's a very able individual. That I accept totally. But I do need that quality as Chief Whip as well. And I wouldn't understate the importance of the Chief Whip's position. And I've seen in previous governments that I've served in the critical role that a Chief Whip plays, also in terms of reforming the Dáil itself and the Oireachtas with other parties.
OK, well, let's look at some of the challenges that are ahead. The biggest one, of course, is coming out of the COVID-19 crisis.
Yes.
And the financial problems that come along with that. If we can look at education first, briefly, the latest interim advice on how to reopen schools in September, principals have said it's unworkable, it's confusing. Why are we not at a position now where we have a plan to reopen our schools?
Well, it is interim advice, and as far as I'm concerned...
But the clock is ticking for something
to
still be interim.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm in government now the last week. The most important point is that we open our schools at the end of August. The development of any child, in my view, is the key issue here for us and for me as Taoiseach. Children need to be back in schools in terms of their life chances, their development. Their life chances will be irreparably repaired if we do not have schools opening in August.
And I don't think anyone disputes that, but the problem is the plan is not there.
Well, sorry, there's a hell of a lot of planning has been done so far. And, you know, we still have some time to obviously work on that, and we'll monitor that interim advice, and that will change over time, I've no doubt. But our task, and I want to make this fairly clear, is we want to reopen our schools as fully as possible to normal at the end of August, both primary and second level. It's extremely important for young people and for children that that happens in terms of their own development and education. And I think that is the focus, that is the target, and that's what we're aiming to do.
OK, now another big issue concerning people is that of international travel. Your own Health Minister, Stephen Donnelly, voicing concerns on Morning Ireland this morning. We've had the Chief Medical Officer telling people actually to cancel their holidays. The current advice, as per the previous government, is that a list will be published this day week of countries that it's OK for people to travel to. Is that still your intention?
Yeah, the situation is the Cabinet Subcommittee will meet on Friday, and we're working now in relation to this. I mean, I am cautious about this, I have to be clear. To me, we've made great progress in suppressing the virus or getting the community transmission very, very low. We have to be very careful that the next steps don't in any way undermine that progress, because we've just spoken about schools. That is a target. If something was to happen between now and August that caused a spike, that could jeopardise schools reopening. The other strand I'm very concerned about is non-COVID illnesses and disease. I want our health services free enough to deal with many, many conditions that haven't been dealt with because of the COVID impact on our health service and health capacity. That said, obviously we will take advice from the public health authorities on Friday. Obviously, we have to look, for example, in terms of procedures, for example, at airports. Well, if we were to, what would need to happen at airports in terms of potentially some testing, contact tracing here when people arrive, for example, that has to be at top notch in terms of speed and so on. What are the criteria and how airplanes will work, okay. How ports and so on, planes and boats and the actual protocols on all of those. So there's a lot of issues to be sorted out. But what is worrying the public health officials and what is worrying me is the continuing volatility at international level. And some countries that were doing well 3 weeks ago are not doing as well now. And so I think we have to be very cautious here, because our economic recovery depends on continued suppression of the virus. You know, and that's why we have to be extremely careful. We don't want to undermine an emerging economy coming out of what has been a very difficult number of months for many sectors of our economy.
And on that point, the economy, already the Exchequer returns figures out today showing a deficit of 5.3 billion for the first 6 months of the year. You've already said we're going to have to borrow our way out of this to get the country back working. Is there an extent to which, or a limit to which, you will go to borrow to get the country back working?
Well, obviously, I think this year we're looking at potentially anything from 25 to 30 billion of a deficit. It's necessary, and just had a call with the Chancellor, Angela Merkel, very clear that Europe has to respond in a similar robust manner in terms of protecting livelihoods, in terms of protecting companies and businesses. So in July, there will be a further government initiative in relation to getting people back to work. And that's why July will be very busy in the Dáil, because we have a number of bills that will underpin that. Credit guarantee scheme, microfinance bill, all designed to give extra supports to small to medium-sized companies, the engine room of our economy. We have to help those companies to come back.
Extending something like the wage subsidy scheme, then the pandemic unemployment payment, they're both due to run out in the middle of August, 10th of August.
They are, and we'll be looking at how we fine-tune those, how we target those, how we prioritise those in terms of...
So there may be something after that? People won't just essentially fall off a financial cliff at that
point? No one will be falling off a cliff. Okay. And I think it's very important that we maintain viability of many companies that in ordinary times would be viable. And so there are cash flow issues, there are capital requirements for companies to reopen under COVID conditions in terms of health and public health conditions. But I think we will get through this, but we have to be prepared to invest in the first phase of this. And government is committed to doing that and working with our social partners, working with all involved to enable safe return to work, but a restoration of economic activity.
That's a lot of borrowing, though, and that just puts the problem down the road. Can you promise people that there won't be a return to the austerity measures that we saw after the last recession, the last time the Fianna Fáil were in government?
This is a different recession. It's
so
a different economic crisis in terms of what has happened in terms of the COVID, which has shut down normally thriving businesses. And the effective way out of this is to create additional investment and funding into the economy right now into next year. But obviously then that will enable us to come through this. And then in the latter end of the government's term, obviously we'll have to correct the balance and so on like that. Well, we can do so with economic growth being the key factor in enabling us to do that.
Now, on that, you've said that you want to be the Taoiseach for all people. You want to work on a recovery for everyone in Ireland. Sinn Féin has been critical of this government, that it doesn't represent the type of change they say that the electorate wanted when it went to the election way back in February, as we remember. Will you be Taoiseach for the whole country? What can you do for those people who are suffering the most right now?
Absolutely. And I think this programme for government does represent very fundamental change, in particularly in terms of dealing with climate and in terms of helping people to cope
with the challenges.
Climate
doesn't do much for people who can't afford a home or their rent.
I'm just going to come to that. And helping people to deal with, for example, access to housing, which is extremely important. Darragh Byrne's already in his office working on that in terms of both affordable housing and in terms of public housing. Health is not just in the context of COVID, but we have an opportunity now to try and really develop long-term capacity within our acute hospital system and also through investment in technology, change the nature and the quality of the engagement between our doctors and patients, both in terms of outpatient consultations, perhaps online, and also primary care, GPs, and how they interact with patients. And I think that is critical. The investment in technology will be very significant. That dovetails with the European Union's Next Generation Recovery Fund, which is also about a Green New Deal, which will create jobs, by the way, in terms of retrofitting and so on, but also in terms of digitalisation and investment in technology, which will create its own potential employment. And broadband, obviously, and the expansion of that into rural Ireland is a key enabler.
That needs cooperation across the whole island as well. And you're going next week, I believe, to meet the First Minister and Deputy First Minister in Northern Ireland. Are you concerned that the current row over the attendance of Michelle O'Neill at Bobby Storey's funeral could lead to the collapse of the Northern Ireland Assembly?
Well, first of all, as Taoiseach, and having been a former Minister for Foreign Affairs, I've been passionate about a shared island for all my political life, and I've worked very hard towards that. And as Taoiseach, I want to give a particular priority to that issue. And that's why there'll be a new unit being developed in this department to scope out and work with all on the island.
But are you concerned that the Assembly may not be there with what we're seeing happening
just coming
today?
To that, we've witnessed for far too long no Assembly and no Executive for a number of years. That cannot be contemplated on this occasion. Under the recent agreement, it seems to me that provision exists for a leaders' forum to be convened. I understand consideration may be given to that to enable the party leaders to come together to resolve this. I understand there are issues to be addressed. I get that. But as Taoiseach, I have to say that it was interesting that COVID-19 facilitated a coming together, if you like, and gave a synergy and a dynamism to the executive that we hadn't quite seen before it. It would be a pity if COVID was to lead to a rupture. And I think it's very, very important that we look at the big picture, keep the Assembly intact, keep the executive intact, of course, and work for the betterment of all the people on this island.
OK, and I'm sure you'll be discussing that next week. We'll have to leave it there for this evening. Taoiseach Micheál Martin, thanks indeed for joining us. Gramíla Machgut, agus all more.
Tough watch your role. Yeah, good one.
That's it from here for the moment. It's back over to you, Vivian.
There's been a significant increase in the number of patients approved to have operations abroad, according to new figures provided to RTE News. Already this year, more than 3,000 cases for treatment in another EU country have been allowed at a cost of 10 million euro.
She's been on the waiting list here for an operation for